Hello there, gorgeous people. This is Chris from Combo, and I'm here with the Alcatel 5, launched at MWC 2018, back at the start of the year. And it's available now in the UK and across Europe for just under £200. So a strong rival for the likes of the Moto G6, for instance, and other mid-range mobiles. Going to do a full unboxing now, get it all set up and see exactly what you can expect from this handset. So first of all the specs are laid out there, but we will go through them one by one as we actually get the device all set up and everything as well. Looking forward to playing with this one. Alcatel phones, generally pretty good value for money. They offer some reasonable specs. You have to take a couple of little hits here and there in terms of the general performance and stuff in order to reach that low asking point. But hopefully should impress. It's got a dual lens front facing camera. Got quite nice design as well, reminiscent of the Sony Xperia XA2. So there's the phone itself. Just going to set that aside for 1 second and just have a quick scout in the rest of the box in case there's anything particularly exciting or outlandish in there. I'm not holding my breath. So quick start guide, obviously. You get a nice little pokey pin device in order to actually stick your SIM card in. Always helpful. Type-C USB cable for charging. You get, looks like some little cheapy headphones. And of course, the plug for it. It's a 2-pin European jobby, but obviously if you buy it in the UK, you can hope to get a 3-pin one instead. Let's actually check out these headphones, because sometimes it's quite rare to get earphones or headphones in a budget smartphone box, but they do look horrendously cheap. Yeah, those are going to scrape the lining from your ear holes, no doubt whatsoever. I thought this was some sort of media control thing, but it just looks to be an Alcatel brand on the cable. So never mind, let's get rid of all this nonsense anyway. And let's check out the actual phone itself. So first of all, is there any juice in the tank? Let's see if we can get it all set up. Yes, there is. Beautiful stuff. So you can get it in a couple of different hues. This is obviously the black model. You can pick it up in gold as well, which I kind of wish we had, because black is always kind of hard to pick up on camera. It's a unibody design, as you can see there, nice and seamless as you stretch from the back round to the edges. Nice and curvaceous as well, so just having a bit of a sing-song. So it fits nicely in the hand, great stuff. It's quite compact as well. It's a 5.7-incher, so not necessarily dinky in terms of the screen size, but thankfully it does have this very lovely edge-to-edge finish, which you can hopefully make out there. Certainly once the screen gets going properly, it'll be a bit more apparent. So there you go, now it's finally come to life. As you can see there, very slender bezels down the sides and down below as well, very little going on there. Usually there's a bit of branding or a fingerprint sensor or something, but in this case, just a narrow little strip and that's about it. Actually really liking the design of this. For a sub £200 phone, it does look very small. It's nice and light as well, 144 grams. Pretty slender, as you can see there as well. Not like super skinny, but definitely for a budget handset, pretty good stuff. Around the back, you see, hopefully you can make out, it's kind of a brushed metal style finish. As you can see there, around the camera lens and fingerprint sensor as well, you get a nice bit of banding too. So that just helps it to stand out, kind of reminiscent of the Nokia 7 Plus. But again, this is an even cheaper handset, so it's nice to see these little premium design touches on a smartphone that's so affordable. And then up top and down below, you get a nice metallic finish, as you can see there, nice and shiny. Again, just helps to break up the overall design of the phone. It's just a nice little touch. Now the Alcatel 5 is running Google Android, but also Alcatel has added a few little bonus features of its own. And one of those is the face key feature, which is basically facial recognition. Very rare to find on a sub £200 smartphone. So we'll be testing it out to see if it's actually any good. Let's just add the face data now. I have to agree to a million terms and conditions. Face key, he looks like a jolly little chap. Right, let's get started. So just put my face in the box. Looks slightly squashed for some reason, but there you go. Okay, 100%. Oh God, I really need to shave, that's awful. I need to look like Grizzly Adams every time I unlock my smartphone, basically. So Alcatel's launcher is, as you can see there, called the Joy Launcher. Very happy and jolly indeed. Let's just allow these permissions. And that just sits nicely on top of Android. As you can see, if you've used an Android phone before, you probably have. A familiar sort of setup. You've still got your apps tray, thankfully, so you don't have to have all your apps clustered there on the desktops or anything weird like that. Pull down the settings menu, got access to all of that. We dive into the settings, probably notice a few additions that Alcatel has made as well. In terms of the SIM cards, you've got a dual SIM tray, although the second one can also be used for micro SD memory cards to expand the 32 gigs of onboard storage up to a further 128 gigs. As you can see, you can manage your SIM cards nice and easily in there. Home screen, you can actually get rid of the apps tray if you're a bit of a masochist. Thankfully, that's not the default option. And you've also got a simple launcher as well if you're going to give it to an elderly relative, someone like that. You've got some gesture support in there as well, so three-finger screenshots, and also you can turn it over to mute any incoming calls, so pretty basic stuff. In the Smart Assistant section, you've got this Joy Touch option, which is basically this little joystick thingy here, which you can move about places. It's just completely disappeared now. Where's it gone to? Okay, well, that's completely vanished, and I've got no idea where to. I'll see if I can bring that back at some point. I tried resetting it, and that doesn't seem to have done anything. In addition to the face unlock, you do, of course, have the fingerprint sensor mounted on the rear, and so far it seems pretty good as well. If you hibernate your phone, just give it a quick tap, and it seems to recognize your finger basically straight away, and as you can see, very minimal delay before getting you into your desktop's quick tap. Nice and responsive. And as you can see, there's some gesture recognition stuff as well. So for instance, on touch or long press, you can get it to go back to the home screen when you're inside of an app apart from the camera. So, or for instance, take a photo if you're inside of the camera as well. So if we dive on into the camera app quickly, just a quick tap, there you go, takes a photo. And if we're in a different app, such as Google Chrome, quick tap or long press, there we go, back into the home screen. So it's got a bit of gesture support as well, completely optional, of course. And then let's try that face unlock as well, out of curiosity, see how that does. So just point it at my mug and hit the power button. And yeah, it seemed pretty good, actually. Not too bad at all. Not as instant as the more premium devices, such as the P20 Pro and stuff, as you would expect. But actually, it seemed to recognize me fairly quick there. So the true test, of course, will be if I change my general facial for setup, start wearing hats, or try it in the dark as well. Those are the true tests to see how good facial recognition really is. You also have an app cloner option as well, which basically allows you to set up a couple of different accounts on the same app. So for instance, WhatsApp, you can have two different WhatsApp accounts, two different Facebook accounts if you're leading a bit of a double life, or you simply have separate personal and work accounts, all good. And you also got Smart Manager as well, which you'll probably need, to be honest, because it's a basic MediaTek chipset running the show. For the more techie of you, it's an MT6750. MediaTek tends to be very basic when it comes to performance, unfortunately, which is one of the cost-cutting measures. But at least it's backed by 3 gigs of RAM instead of 2 gigs, unlike the Honor 7S, which I recently reviewed, which was absolutely bloody awful in the performance, unfortunately. But then it was less than 100 quid, so to be expected. So far, touch wood, it seems to be doing all right. The odd little stutter and stumble here and there, but then I've only just set it up, so that's to be expected. So we'll sort of see how the general performance holds up over the next few days ahead of my in-depth review. But at least you do have that Smart Manager section, so you can dive into here. You can free up any memory by closing down any apps that are busy sapping all your power, all that kind of stuff. And you can see exactly which is apps are allowed to auto-start as well. So if there's anything you don't particularly use very often, then you can just make sure it doesn't start up automatically, just whenever you manually want to use it. And plenty of power saving options in there as well. It's a 3000 milliamp cell packed inside, so I'm kind of hoping it'll get at least a full day of pretty intensive use. But again, I'll be testing that out ahead of the full review. And it looks like you do at least have some power saving modes to jump on board with if you're struggling come the end of the day. And you can see which apps are draining your power and deal with those cheeky little blighters as well, which is always handy. Now, I haven't really talked about the display yet. It's a 5.7 inch IPS display. It's a stretched 18:9 aspect ratio, which is of course very common these days. It's quite handy for a bit of Netflix, YouTube, things like that. Anything with a more cinematic finish to it just means that you get less bezels, so you get more of a viewing area. And also, it's HD Plus as well, so 1440 by 720. So not as sharp as some of its closer rivals, but in terms of general video playback, checking out your photos, things like that, should be nice and detailed. If you just open up the apps tray, just get in there nice and close, you can hopefully see that it's pretty sharp. And in terms of the colors and everything, seems absolutely fine, you know, not particularly punchy, but will do the job. And viewing angles, again, absolutely fine, so as good as you would hope for under 200 quid. If you just boost the brightness as well, seems reasonably bright. Not one of the brightest panels we've played with, but should be absolutely fine if you're using it out of doors. Unfortunately, it does seem to be running Android Nougat 7.0. I haven't played with a smartphone that uses that in a long time. They've all been Android Oreo. So that's a bit of a shame, but hopefully it'll get an update. I will get in touch with Alcatel and see if that is on the cards. As you can see, the Android security patch level is well back in the day as well, 5th of November 2017. So let's see if there's any updates waiting at the moment. System is up to date. Okay. We've got an update on the go, so hopefully that'll sort some of that out. So we've performed the system update, and as you can see, the phone is now fully up to date. There's nothing else remaining to be pulled down. Unfortunately, we are still on Android Nougat version 7.0. The Android security level has been updated to 5th of February, still a bit behind, unfortunately. Hopefully that'll be rectified soon. And which gubbins brings us onto the camera tech. So as you can see here on the back is a single lens snapper. It's a 12 megapixel camera lens with f2.2 aperture. So probably won't be great in those low light situations, unfortunately, but it does have a bit of phase detection autofocus. Hopefully it will latch onto your subject quite nippily. Quite an interesting little app. As you can see, you've got fast access to the video as well as just general photos. So that's good. And then you've got some fast access stuff at the top here. You've got an automatic HDR mode, you've got some filters if you want it, the flash, and a night mode as well. And it can actually change between those, as you can see, night mode, HDR, etc., etc. So it does all that for you on the fly. And you've also got access to handy little one-handed controls as well. So if you are using it one-handed, you can't stretch all the way up to the top. You can just move everything down to the bottom here, and you can do that either for the left or the right. The shutter action seems pretty nippy so far. I'll be giving it a full testing out ahead of my in-depth review, of course. And if you want to access the bonus camera modes, you can just give that a quick tap. As you can see, very simple ones. You've got panorama mode, time lapse and slow motion footage as well. Light trace, I'm guessing, is basically like the light mode on the Huawei cameras. So yeah, as you can see there, capture light at night, and it just basically, yeah, if you wave your torch about or whatever, it will capture like a light stream. Basically, so that's there if you want it. And there's a social mode, and I've got no flipping clue whatsoever what this is. Looks interesting though. Can you maybe shoot a bow thing? No, I'm not really sure what is going on there. Completely random. If we dive on into the settings as well, you'll see it maxes out at full HD 1080p footage. You can't shoot 4K as you'd expect at this sort of price point, but you do get some basic digital image stabilization on there, so I'll be testing that out as well. And as you can see, the one-hand mode you can deactivate if you want to. More intriguing is the dual front-facing camera setup. You actually get two camera lenses, a 13 megapixel f2.0, I believe it is, and a 5 megapixel depth sensor as well. So if we actually get out of this, go back into auto mode, and then swap around to the front-facing camera, there we go. As you can see, there is a flash mode as well, so let's just turn that on and try giving it a bit of a hit. So it's a proper flash, not just a bog standard LED that turns on. And as you can see, you've got usual filters, got full auto mode and everything. Got beauty mode by the looks of it, so let's max me out because I am looking a little bit disheveled at the moment. Oh, there we go. So I'm not sure what this one does. Some sort of sparkly thing. And then that one obviously just gets rid of the crow's eye, whatever it's called, crow's feet, is it? And all the other gubbins that, it's got limited effect, unfortunately, on me. I have just gotten up, so that's probably why. So there you go, so you got your beauty mode and everything if you so desire. And also, I believe it's got 120 degree wide angle on it. So if we sold it right out, as you can see there, you can fit quite a lot of stuff in. So good if you're taking a bit of a shot of you and your mates, or if you're going to try and get some sexy architecture in the background, whatever you are up to. So it seems like a pretty feature-packed camera for the price. Is it any good? That is the main question. I will, of course, be fully testing it out, so stay tuned for the in-depth review. And what do you reckon of the Alcatel 5? For about 180 quid, seems to rock a very nice design, some decent little features, including that face recognition, and hopefully some respectable camera tech. So would you be tempted to grab one? Definitely let us know in the comments down below. Or would you be more swayed by the likes of the Moto G6? Always interesting to hear from you lovely, gorgeous people. So don't forget to give us a subscribe as well if you are new to the Recombu fold. And thanks for watching, everyone. Love you.